Good evening, and welcome to another episode of Our Natural Resources with me, Chris Roberts, and Larry Penny as co-hosts. Tonight we're fortunate enough to have some wonderful guests with us to explain the wonderful world of herptiles, and that is Andrew Sabin from the South Fork Natural History Society and Marty Shea from the town of Southampton Natural Resources Department. So we're all pretty well represented here tonight, and we have an interesting video for you to look at. So Larry, just a brief comment before we go into the video.
These two gentlemen know as much about salamanders on the South Fork as anyone, and so I think we should learn a lot, Chris. Unfortunately, we don't have tiger salamanders where we work, and hopefully we can sneak a few
that would be
in
nice.
There after
yeah.
the show.
Yeah. And we have some live salamanders for you tonight to look at firsthand, up close, right here in the studio with us, thanks to Andy Sabin's kind generosity. So, without further ado, Sherman, let's go to the videotape, and we're going to explore some of the ramifications of salamanders here on the East End.
Long Island is one of the few parts of upland North America that was created within the last 20,000 years. After its formation at the end of the Wisconsin glaciation, it wasn't barren and lifeless for long. As the land warmed up, and while sea level was hundreds of feet lower than now, all manner of animals wandered in to occupy it. Perhaps members of the group of salamanders we call the mole salamanders were among the last to get here. Coming up along the coastal plain, they must have had to cross the Hudson River and East River floodplain deltas by way of Staten Island. Not all of the mole salamanders got here, but the four species that did must not have come in the same wave. In fact, there may have been as many as four different waves. It would seem that the first to come to Long Island, judging by its appearance at the eastern tip of it, was the blue-spotted salamander. Today on Long Island, it is found only in Montauk. For the last 4,000 or 5,000 years or so, Montauk has been a virtual island, completely separated by marine waters from the Long Island mainland as recently as 1,000 to 2,000 years ago. How else can we explain the presence of the blue spot in Montauk, except by a very early arrival when the coastal plain between the south and north was near continuous and much farther seaward than it is today? Judging from the current distribution of mole salamanders on Long Island, the last to arrive was the tiger salamander. It is scant on the North Fork and on the South Fork, never got farther east than what is today central East Hampton Town. The marbled salamander managed to get a little farther east, all the way to Amagansett. The spotted salamander is the most ubiquitously distributed, found on both forks and on two of the three islands in the Peconic Estuary. However, it is not found in many suitable habitat areas in central and western Long Island, suggesting that it might have been displaced by the larger, more aggressive tiger salamander as that species moved east. Of the three mole salamanders that breed in the spring, the tiger on Long Island breeds the earliest, as early as in the first week in February, but generally not until the end of February and first week in March. The spotted and blue-spotted salamander don't breed until mid-March. In areas of eastern Long Island where their habitats and ranges overlap, such as in coastal ponds south of Sag Harbor and north of Bridgehampton, it is not uncommon to find three mole salamander species, the tiger, spotted, and marble, occupying the same pond. In general, however, on the South Fork, spotted salamanders are found in the lower-lying ponds, those that are fed by groundwater, which may be as little as 100 or 200 feet from the sea. It is is likely that tiger salamanders were once found in 9 of the 10 townships on Long Island. They probably never occurred on Shelter Island, the township situated in the Peconic Estuary. However, they have been very scarce since World War II, perhaps owing to the widespread use of aerially broadcast pesticides for gypsy moths and the intense ground-level application of oils and mosquito poisons in the decades that followed. By the advent of the mid-1970s, tiger salamanders had disappeared from many formerly occupied habitats and were scarce throughout their Long Island range. They appear to be making a comeback. At first, it was thought by biologists that they required very specialized aquatic conditions for breeding. On Long Island, those conditions were morainal ponds, mostly kettle holes, a good many of which were vernal. They were above the water table and only became sufficiently filled for breeding during rainy years. During droughty times on Long Island, groundwater ponds in the moraine would frequently go dry, limiting breeding to only wet years. Not so for the spotted salamander on eastern Long Island, which breed almost exclusively in water table ponds. Those situated a good distance from the top of the groundwater mound and thus insulated from drying up. During the renewed search for the tiger salamander on Long Island's South Fork, beginning in the early 1980s, exhaustive examinations of many of these spotted salamander haunts would frequently turn up marbled salamanders, but no tiger salamanders, even though many of these ponds were deep and eminently suitable for tiger breeding. Detailed search of several local ponds that had been known breeding habitats for the tiger salamander as recently as the 1960s failed to disclose them in the 1980s. Such East Hampton sites as Two Holes of Water and Wood Duck Pond that were once regularly visited by public school biology classes for tigers in the 1950s and 1960s were now devoid of them. During the 1980s, Long Island's South Fork experienced an unprecedented building boom as what has now become to be known as New York City's bedroom community pushed east. If there were tiger salamanders to be found, who would get to them first? The bulldozer operator clearing the land for second homers from the city, or the naturalists who wondered if they were still there? The sense of the hunt was heightened by an act of the New York State Legislature in 1981. It created a state endangered species list and put the tiger salamander on it. The search went on to no avail. Professional biologists looking into the whereabouts of the tiger salamander had given up where the South Fork was concerned. Then, in March 1986, an amateur herpetologist, Andrew Sabin, turned the tables. On a cold, rainy night, while most local males were inside watching television or reading to their children, he was reconnoitering ponds in a chain of ponds area between the bay on the north and the ocean on the south. His lantern beam that had failed to find anything so many times in the past fell upon some yellow markings of a sinuous salamander form. It began to swim down, quick with the net, then into the hand, under the light. It was, indeed, a tiger salamander. the first to be turned up on the South Fork since a larva was taken from a Southampton kettle hole in 1966. Since the tiger salamander was now state endangered, and since it was refound on the South Fork, development of the morainal lands there took on a new twist. The very ponds that were to serve as the cynoshores of the new subdivisions, the views from the window, so to speak, were also the preferred breeding spots for tiger salamanders. The subdivisions would have to be redesigned to accommodate the salamanders. Some, such as Bridgewood, south of Sag Harbor, were able to do so, but not without a great hoop-de-doo. Some, like Whiskey Hill, were not able to. They fell into oblivion. The tiger salamander, which had yielded so readily to so many in the past, had begun to dig in its heels as it headed into the future. With more and more municipalities, in addition to the State Department of Environmental Conservation on Long Island, protecting wetlands and ponds, it would seem that in the big picture of things, the tiger salamander population on Long Island, what is left of it, may be more secure now than it has ever been since the white man first established here 370 years ago. Sufficient upland around the aquatic habitats must be preserved too, however, if the salamander larvae that metamorphose in the water are to survive and grow to reproductive maturity on land. Only a few years ago, it was thought that 100 feet of upland buffer would suffice. Now, we know that as much as 10 times that amount is needed to protect the salamanders around each breeding pond. Yes, the tiger salamander on Long Island is on the road back, but only scrupulous attention to planning details and land use practices will ensure its recovery here. Seemingly harmless appurtenances of modern living can wreak havoc on tiger salamanders. They are trapped and subverted in all matter of man-made depressions such as window wells, storm basins, swimming pools, and the like. Hard curbs on roadways, such as those that are now the rage, made from Belgian block, provide running fences by which herptiles are corralled into drainage pits. One suspects that none, if any, recover from such sudden falls into deep, dark concrete-lined holes. On the other hand, we are beginning to find out that tiger salamanders tolerate disturbed aquatic habitats. Farm ponds and golf course waterholes have long been the favorite of the Long Island's snapping turtle. Apparently, many a tiger salamander uses them as well. Sumps dug besides major arterioles for receiving road runoff and pools of water in sand quarry pits have recently become the annual breeding grounds for small subpopulations of tiger salamanders, despite the fact that the former frequently receive salts and other contaminants, while the latter are often surrounded by acres of sterile sand. Large fish and bullfrogs are supposed to be inimical to the tigers, but lately a few ponds have been uncovered in which salamander, fish, and frog are all present in a kind of cohabitation which is not altogether untoward to the salamander. As scientists are so wont to say, when in pursuit of this or that research object, especially where grant money may be in the offing, quote, there is much we don't know, there is much we need to know, unquote. It is certainly true that where the survival of the tiger salamander on Long Island is concerned, that what we don't know might hurt us.
Especially if you happen to like salamanders and all the great things that they bring, Larry. What can we say about the tiger salamanders of our area?
Let's hope that video does convert a few people out there who are watching, because sometimes salamanders are feared in the way that snakes are feared or lizards are feared. But there's absolutely nothing to fear about our salamanders. We don't have any poisonous salamanders.
Beautiful, beautiful creatures.
I think we saw that salamanders may be on the road back. Would you say that's true, Andy?
It's hard to say because we don't really know how much destruction or what the population we started with was. What we do know is that we're finding the sites now, and we're protecting the sites that we do find. And in those sites, I think that the populations are probably growing, because now we've started protecting their upland habitat.
For instance, in the town of Southampton, what specifically, how are they protected over there, Marty?
Well, Chris, we're real fortunate in Southampton. We have about 20 documented breeding sites for the tiger salamander. And it's quite an exciting time. We have a lot of initiatives underway. In the western part of the town, you're probably aware, we're just in the process of unveiling a town plan for creating a Pine Barrens Preserve. That's going to afford permanent protection to virtually all the tiger salamander breeding sites at the west end of the town. In the east end, where development's more of a problem, there's a number of things we're doing. We're just initiating a study to look at the cumulative impacts of development on the tiger salamander. That's in Central Bridge, Hampton. The goal of the study is actually to put together a good, solid, long-term plan for making development of the area compatible with the tiger salamander's needs.
Well, what specifically can be done to protect a breeding site, for instance, a pond in the middle of a subdivision or golf course? Are there any parameters set up there?
Well, there's a number of things that's important. First of all, land protection is obviously important. You want to map out the breeding site, the primary residence site in the surrounding woodlands. You want to protect the resident habitat and breeding habitat, and you also want to protect the migratory corridors. You see in the film, a lot was said about the impacts of roads and curbing. Well, one of the things we've done in Southampton Town is we've revised our road standards so that country lanes can be created. These are curbless roads. These are roads where the drainage devices do not have those big gaping holes that are going to catch salamanders. The roads are a lot narrower, they're a lot smaller, and they're being designed to really avoid the tiger salamander habitats.
So some minor design changes and makes it easier for the salamanders.
Sure, there's actually it's pretty simple in terms of finding the ways to greatly improve the chances for tiger salamander survival.
Now, who would go out and look for these salamanders, Andy?
I was just going to say, the big challenge that we have today on the South Fork, and I guess all through Long Island, is to identify the breeding sites. Because without identifying them, we can't stop the fragmentation and the ruining of their habitats. Mm-hmm. I go out oftentimes in starting first week in January up until about the middle of March, looking for new breeding sites. And you can go to the same site. I've gone to some sites 5, 6, 7 years in a row, found nothing, and all of a sudden I get lucky. Mm-hmm. So you just have to get there the right day, the right night. Weather conditions have to be perfect to find them.
And Larry, what makes these salamanders so rare and exotic? It was hinted at in the video how they were
Oh, I don't know, but I have some questions I'd like to ask of my own over
sure.
here. And one of the questions is, Andy, tiger salamanders now, and all these mole salamanders, they don't really stay in the ponds that long. So we mainly think of salamanders as in the ponds breeding. But there's a time when they're out of the ponds. And that's also a vulnerable period, isn't it?
I'd say it's a very vulnerable period. You have, they probably only spend maybe 2 weeks a year in the pond. And one of the reasons that they're hard to find is because the rest of the time they're underground or they're under logs. They're subject not only to predation in the pond, but when they're traveling on wet nights, you have things like raccoons. When they're in certain mole tunnels, they could come across something that might kill them also.
And so you got to protect them in the two areas. I think Marty did say that, the upland and the aquatic habitat.
Actually, they both have to be protected. But the upland habitat is probably as important, if not more important. What we found from recent studies, including one on Long Island recently where we used radio telemetry, where we actually put transmitters in the salamanders, we know they travel at least 1,000 feet from their breeding sites. And we've found them as much as a quarter of a mile from any water. We don't even know how they got there.
In fact, it used to be thought, there was an old rule of thumb, that 100 feet away from the pond and you're safe, you're protecting that's no longer true, is it? But in fact, some of these salamanders were even found in woodchuck holes and holes created by other rodents and so forth.
It was interesting, in this radio telemetry study, they found one salamander. It was down 10 feet. It had followed a root of a tree, and it was 10 feet below the ground. But normally, I would say they're 1 to 2 feet below the ground. Sometimes during the fall, when we have rains this time of year, from now until November, they will come up and be under some rotting logs, and sometimes you can find them. But normally they're so secretive, and I think that's one of the reasons we really don't know all the breeding sites or where they're found, is because they're underground and you only have that two-week window,
right,
which could occur anywhere from the middle of January to the middle of March.
Depending on the weather.
Depending on the weather, the humidity, the rain, it's a bunch of factors.
And in Southampton, you found, Marty, that things have been picking up with the tiger salamander in the sense that, are you doing a census or are you doing an inventory? You know, you're keeping tabs on populations or breeding sites?
Yeah, we're actually doing quite a lot of work, Chris. We're continually every year monitoring the breeding sites, both in the winter and the summer, thanks to Andy's help, thanks to the help of the group for the South Fork. We're also working on the regulations so we can better protect the habitat. We've recently strengthened our land subdivision regulations so that we can protect quite a lot of open space in environmentally sensitive areas like tiger salamander breeding locations. We use mechanisms like very tight clustering to protect those areas. We just passed a new wetlands law, which affords protection up to 200 feet from the edge of a pond or wetland area. One of the new things about this wetlands law is that it controls the use of fertilizers and pesticides, which can have an impact on the quality of the breeding sites and on tiger salamander populations.
Sounds far-reaching.
Sure is.
Andy, let's see some of the critters you brought today with you.
Oh, okay. Well, this is a time of year when one of the mole salamanders, the marbled salamander, is the only one. It's a fall breeding salamander. And, okay, let me get this guy up here. Thank you. Here we have a female marbled salamander.
Get a close-up on that one, Walter.
Excellent.
Beauty, huh? Coloration on that.
Actually,
this is the wrong. One of the two we saw in the video.
Two females.
Ah, they're stars.
Yeah, they're stars. This is one of our four mole salamanders, but it's the only one that breeds in the fall. This is a very interesting salamander. What it does is it goes to dried up vernal pools right into the middle and will lay his eggs anytime from the middle of September to the middle of October. And then as the water fills up these vernal kettles, as soon as the water hits the eggs will hatch. Mm. And these larvae actually will be active all through the winter.
Hmm.
And oftentimes when we start looking at ponds in January and February, we'll see the marbled larvae swimming around.
That's amazing.
You know, I might add that the marbled salamander was rediscovered on the South Fork by a DEC biologist, Scotty Crookle, who found it while he was investigating the Grace Estate back in about 1983, and since that time, found several, right?
Yeah, it's been interesting. I was out last week after the heavy rain, and I went to one vernal pool. There were 47.
Oh, my Lord.
Where these two came from, and I'm going to release those tonight right after the show.
Yes, that's a good point to be mentioned, yeah.
Yeah. I don't advise anybody to keep salamanders as pets. They do not make good pets. They're very, very difficult to keep, and you're better off coming on one of our nature walks, observe it in the wild, enjoy it.
Good point, Andy.
But don't try and keep it as a pet at home.
And you have a permit for your handling of these reptiles, I take it.
Yeah, I have a permit issued by the state DEC to handle endangered species. Mm-hmm. This particular salamander is not endangered, although it is probably as rare on the South Fork as the tiger salamander.
How about another salamander here? They go to the spring peeper. Okay, how about the spotted salamander? Here's another mole salamander.
Okay.
And you know what? You notice that Andy's putting these things back pretty quick, because if they dry out, then they can't breathe through their skin. So that's the quickest way to kill salamanders, other than stepping on them.
Let's see if we can focus in on this spotted metamorph here.
Mm-hmm. We just looked at two adults. Now we're looking at a half-grown one.
Why don't you put some more out while Walter's getting that off?
No, that's all we have in there.
And we have one other species back here. We have some...
We're going to go one at a time.
We have some redback salamanders here, the lead phase.
Oh, there you go. Wonderful. See the spots on that baby there, huh? Pretty nice looking.
The lead phase, which you're about to see, is actually real common. It's a terrestrial salamander. It's very common in Oak Woods throughout Southampton area.
I don't know if we can get it. Can we get this, Walter?
You have to look under a rotting log for one of these guys, I understand, huh?
Doesn't have to go to water to breed, right? Mm-hmm.
Where my finger is, this is the lead-back phase of the redback salamander. It's probably the most common salamander on Long Island. The very interesting thing about it is on the North Fork, it has a red phase rather than this lead phase, which we find here on the South Fork. Going to Gardner's Island, you find both phases.
Mm-hmm.
And Chris today saw 25 in his swimming pool. I'm sure we all see them often in our swimming pools.
I remember these in Matatuck on the North Fork when I was a boy, and we never got gray phases. We only got the red phases. And Marty, you say that you only get gray phases in
Southampton.
Well, with the last minute we have to discuss
discuss one more thing, if I could. You see here the spotted salamander. It looks considerably smaller than the marble. The reason for that is this is a first-year metamorph. This particular metamorph just transformed from its aquatic stage to its land phase. Normally, it's considerably larger as an adult than the marbled salamander, which we saw earlier.
Okay, well, that sounds wonderful. Gosh, I wish we had a lot more time to discuss the salamanders and play with them, I guess, is look at them anyway. But Marty Shea, I want to thank you very much for showing up tonight. Andrew Sabin, again, it's a pleasure. We'll have
to
do it again. Larry, we'll have to schedule another show for salamanders. This just went too quickly. And for all the cast and crew here, for all the cast and crew here at Our Natural Resources, see you in 2 weeks. Remember, they're our natural resources.
makes a difference in our life. Amagansett speaks. Amagansett and you.
I'm Joan Tope, and I'd like to invite you to join us on our program, Amagansett Speaks. Amagansett Speaks will be introducing people from Amagansett who make a difference in our lives. People who, because of their efforts and commitment, make our lives safer, more enlightened, and richer. These people are directly responsible for our better quality of life. These are people who make a difference. Today, my guest is Andy Sabin, president of the South Fork Natural History Society, known as SOFO. Welcome, Andy. I'm very glad to have you here. I'd like to ask you something about the history about SOFO.
Well, SOFO was founded in 1989 by a group of local naturalists, myself, Chris McKeever, who has since passed away, Jim Ash, who is one of the best local naturalists, Larry Penny, and Gene Held, who's a local naturalist, who's a real expert in mushrooms. And what we decided was we needed an educational group out here to enhance the understanding of the nature of the flora and fauna of the South Fork. What we wanted to do was be a non-political force here. We weren't interested in competing with the groups here that fight developments or buy land. What we wanted to do is to teach young and old about the nature of the South Fork.
And that's what you're doing.
And that's what we're doing.
I know the society, you know, somewhat. I'm a member, and I think it's just fantastic. What inspired you to form the society? Just because you love it here, or you love...
I love it here, but we didn't feel there were any of the groups were really educating the people. And we look forward to the young people today being the future stewards of Amagansett, East Hampton, South Hampton, the whole South Fork.
That's so worthwhile, I think. Yeah. I think it's just wonderful that you do that. And that. Now tell us, are the activities very related, I guess? What activities do you have? And I'm sure a lot are for children and adults
as well.
Well,
we have 500 members, and we have a tremendous number of activities. Every week in the East Hampton Star, you'll see a schedule. We have activities at least three or four times a week. We also have three or four times a month. But we also have every weekend a program. We have a clubhouse now in Amagansett, which is a prelude to our nature center.
Which I want to hear about later.
Right.
But now tell me about some of the activities.
Well, what we do, let me tell you a little about the nature center. Every weekend, we invite children over, South Fork children, and during the week, classes actually come to this nature clubhouse in Amagansett and have a hands-on experience with butterflies, turtles, frogs, plants. They have a chance to go to a small pond and look for fish. So they have a hands-on experience. Mm-hmm. Now, in addition to that, we have a number of nature walks and lectures and things throughout the year.
Where is the Nature Center?
It's in Amagansett off of where the confluence of Old Montauk Highway and New Montauk Highway, almost opposite the Amoco Station.
Also, oh, I don't know where that is, but I should know.
Near the beauty...
near the beauty salon, right,
right
there. Oh,
yeah.
And they meet there, and then you go out...
No, we meet there, and we have a clubhouse.
I see.
And we have a number of exhibits in this clubhouse. This clubhouse is actually in the back of my property.
I see.
And I have two ponds on the property, and the children go to the ponds and look at the different wildlife. And in the clubhouse, we have a number of exhibits.
I'd love to come over. Mm. I actually didn't know this, and I would love to come visit. What other sort of activities do you
do? We have these different nature walks, and depending on what we're looking at, for example, if I'm doing a nature walk on salamanders, we might meet in Montauk, or we might meet in Bridgehampton. If we're doing something on tropical fish in August, where a lot of people don't realize that what you have out here is the Gulf Stream is off the coast, obviously comes off the coast, and warm water eddies come off of the Gulf Stream. And believe it or not, many of the tropical fish that you see sold, saltwater tropical fish being sold in pet stores, can actually be found here in the middle and end of September. So we take
something
the kids seining for these tropical fish, and they come up with a number of species which are really native to Florida and the Caribbean, which is a really enjoyable experience for them.
Where do you go seining, like for these fish?
This is near the, I guess, just east of the Shinnecock Canal. There's a few places.
See, I never knew half this. I see Andy all the time, and I just never knew you did all these things.
And then we have, like, Gene is an expert on mushrooms. Mm-hmm. And we have a number of walks to introduce people to mushrooms and collecting and for eating and to learn the different species, which are poisonous, which are edible, which is quite interesting. And then Jim Ash, of course, who's one of the best all-around naturalists on the South Fork, does a lot of our bird walks. And I think one of the interesting things about what we're doing, these bird walks we've designed for handicapped and senior citizens.
I noticed.
We have a number of walks where we call it birding by car, and maps are available at our clubhouse, where we take out maybe 6 or 10 people in a bus, which might be donated by the Hampton Jitney, for example, mm-hmm. and people who can't walk around but can come with a naturalist and even sit in the car with the binoculars like this, and it's wonderful.
It is. I mean, what a thing to offer people, especially people who can't go out with the regular birders.
Exactly.
I mean, and face the weather and whatever.
The other thing we have, it's interesting for these, we have people that are physically, that can't see.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
So we take them out and we have what they call birding by ear. And we get to where birds are singing, and some of them can listen to the birds, and we'll identify them by voice.
And have you gotten a lot of people to
We're getting a fair amount of people. We've come up with a bunch of lists, checklists, which are available at our clubhouse, or if you become members of the South Fork Natural History Society. We have a checklist, for example, if you want to take your child or an adult looking for seashells. We have all the seashells. We have all the reptiles and amphibians with a checklist, when to find them, if they're rare, common. We have wildflowers, we have birds. So it really gives somebody a chance to really learn about nature, even without a naturalist, with just this checklist and a guidebook. You can go out and we can give you information on where to go.
Because I got some of those books, I think because I'm a member,
yeah.
I was
checklist.
Sent, yes, the checklist, right. And they're beautiful books, they've got, or pamphlets, I guess they are. And it does tell you what, it identifies all
what
the various things. And so what, do you need volunteers for
you? We always need volunteers, but I wanted to just get back to something. A lot of the work, we're trying to teach people to do things naturally, rather than using all of these pesticides and fungicides and everything else. We try to promote natural use of using the natural environment. For example, we supply bat boxes, and you probably don't realize that a bat might eat 3,000 mosquitoes a night or 2,000 mosquitoes
a
night.
No, I didn't know that.
We provide gourds and purple martin houses or information on how to do that, which also are big insect eaters. Rather than spray or use zappers or something like that, we try to promote natural predators. We are promoting the use of barn owl boxes. Barn owls love the white-footed mouse,
which
carries the Lyme disease.
Yeah.
But if you could get an owl, especially a barn owl, uh-huh. You have an animal there that'll eat 8 or 9 of these mice.
But how do people get that if they wanted
what
a bat box, say, for instance?
If you want a bat box or any type of box, you call Carol Krassen at 267-7944, which is the Nature Line, and you call Carol, and mm-hmm. We sell a number of boxes, and a number of are available commercially. But we can also give you ideas about putting up wood piles to attract snakes. I mean, if you understand that these snakes will eat the same mouse that has the Lyme disease, you're promoting natural predation rather than using all of these. The chemicals that you have to use to get rid of ticks are so poisonous, they'll kill just about anything.
We only have a few minutes left, Andy. What's the future for SOHO?
No, it's SOFO.
SOFO, I said.
SOHO.
SOFO.
The future is, we're presently in discussions with the Montauk County Park. We have had a proposal before them for 1.5 years to build a natural history museum there. They were waiting for the master plan to be finished. And it looks like we will be able to have our nature center and nature museum at Montauk County Park.
I know that's your dream.
It's our dream. We're going to build it from scratch. We already have funding of over $100,000 to start it. We have we've also lined up future funding to complete the museum. We're asking for no public funds from a county or state entity, because I think that's history. There are people that have this dream that the state, the county, everybody's going to finance their projects. We've come to the reality that we have to do this ourselves.
And I know you will, Andy. Yeah. You do what you say you're going to do. Just one more time, I'd like to just say, have Andy tell you the phone number for SOFO and how you can get the newsletter, which is wonderful, and the booklets that they put out, and any information.
Right. Well, I don't know if anybody's ever seen our newsletter. We did one on Gardner's Island. These are collector's items, which are at the Museum of Natural History. But if you call Carol Krassen, her number is 516-267-7944. She'll send a membership brochure. She'll give you a list, guide lists. She'll tell you where to get bat boxes. And it's also a nature hotline. If you have a disabled animal, or you have a situation where, for example, you have a bat in your attic and you're scared to death of it, we'll come over and rescue the bat. Or we'll take your injured animal to a licensed wildlife rehabilitator.
So remember that, everybody, if anything happens. And, you know, we want you to know, Andy, that you really do make a difference in our lives, and we thank you so much for coming today. And now, Amagansett Speaks, a film about the people who live in Amagansett.
The people who are going to speak to you on this film live in Amagansett. Some of them have lived here for generations. Some moved here recently. But they all have one thing in common, and that is a special love for Amagansett. We ask them two questions. What makes Amagansett special for you? And what is there about Amagansett that makes you want to live here?
Amagansett's a nice small community. Everybody knows pretty much everybody. And when you go to East Hampton or Montauk, it's getting more commercialized. We're still pretty countryfied out here, I guess you could say.
Well, Amagansett's that town that everybody tells you about. Don't blink or you'll miss it. And you don't want to miss it because it's a very, very special place.
I like the small size. Not a lot of people in traffic. We live on Main Street, so we could walk everywhere.
I love Amagansett.
It's small and quiet, and it's the way we like it.
That's one of the things I love about Amagansett. You can, you know, it's got charm, it's quaint, and it isn't overdeveloped.
Amagansett is a town where East Hampton, I think, is really more suburbia. And it's quieter, it's peaceful. You get to know your neighbors.
I grew up on Oak Lane, and for us, East Hampton was the city. That's where all the stores and shops were, and although Amagansett now is getting more and more. We used to just have just this small Main Street and a few stores on the north side of the road, but now, down across from Amagansett School was Aunt Ryan's grocery store. And across the street from him was the George Ailes Garage. Both of them places are gone. They no longer exist.
I'm a visitor here to Amagansett. I've been here a few days, and I'm really surprised what a small town, small village atmosphere there is about everybody, and how friendly everybody is.
I just like being in a small town with less asphalt than other places, and I don't know, it's just a nice feeling to be here and knowing everybody.
It's quiet, it's peaceful, it's got all the small town characteristics that we like so much.
I guess it's the close proximity to the Atlantic Ocean and some of the finest beaches that I've ever seen, and the small town atmosphere, whereby when you go to the post office or to the bank, the people greet you by first name. That's a nice.
I love the calm and the peace and the easygoing way of life here. It's not in the fast lane.
Well, one thing that makes it special for me is that it's a small community, and you can trust everyone in it, and you can know where everybody is, and you don't have to worry about anybody cheating you out of something or not being trustworthy to you.
I was in Spain for 10 days and couldn't wait to get back here to enjoy the rural atmosphere. I am well acquainted with the Hamptons, Southampton, East Hampton, and West Hampton and so forth, and I can always consider them a bit glitzy. This area has a certain rural charm which fits me very well.
I like the playground in my school.
I like the small size of the town. It's not too congested. Even though it's busy in the summer, it's manageable.
Well, Amagansett is special to me because I've lived here all my life. I was a commercial fisherman, and being able to make a living from the water every day, getting up and seeing something different. It's quiet, it's peaceful, it's clean. It was a good, clean living. Everybody in town knows each other. Everybody knew when you were catching fish, and everybody knew when you weren't. Everybody cared about what was happening. You know, it's a special kind of place that people pitch in and help each other out when they're down, or, you know, they need something, or if there's something going on around town. Everybody seems to just kind of come together and do what it takes to get the job done. That's very special in a community.
Aside from my husband and my children, Amagansett is the love of my life. In 1950, I came off the Long Island Railroad, walked down Main Street, and it was beautiful, down Indian Wells and to the ocean. That was in 1950, and now today I can still do the same thing, find the same beauty, the same tree-lined streets, the same ocean and bay. I can look out on the farmland and the open spaces. It's the place where I find the most inner peace.
We chose Amagansett specifically for the quality of life it had to offer. We loved the small town feel. We came from a town very similar to this from Massachusetts, and what really appealed to us was that small town, quaint, simple lifestyle. We loved the fact that there weren't any fast food restaurants, that there weren't any malls.
Like going in the beach?
I'd like to see it the way it is now. I don't want to see any big changes. I don't want to see any big chains come in. I think the parking is already a problem in Amagansett, and I don't want to see any big anything come in here. Just keep it the way it is.
Amagansett is still quiet. It's different. They're seeking something that's more countrified, not citified. They find East Hampton a little bit too frenetic, too busy. East Hampton, people say, is becoming like the city. And so we see people are looking for like a little village, the quaintness, the charm.
Well, I grew up in Springs, and when I got married, my husband lived in Amagansett, and I liked it better because it's more quiet. East Hampton's too busy, and we live on a nice street down by the lumber yard, and I just like the area a lot.
Amagansett has the charm that the rest of the towns have lost from being overdeveloped.
Amagansett's a small town. It's grown since I was a child. East Hampton is much bigger. The crowds are much larger. The traffic is atrocious. Amagansett's traffic's getting that way. It's not as bad as East Hampton. I'm starting to find in Amagansett a hard time getting out onto the highways from my road.
What Amagansett retains is still a small town feeling. In spite of the discount store situation, it's pretty. It's pretty. It's the way the old Stearns used to look, which was pretty. Old little sort of farmhouses or whatever they were, the polo club, which never looked like a very big polo club, but homey. And that's what Amagansett still retains. They have nice places that aren't fancied up to eat in, like Estia's and the delicatessen has good sandwiches and things like this, which make it much easier, more relaxed to live in Amagansett.
I open my eyes underwater.
The patient client
The people out here are very nice, and it's like my Shangri-La. It's going to add years to my life, I think, out here.
It's America as it was, in a way, and it's just a nice, quiet, relaxing, offbeat, people very friendly, lovely beaches, marvelous facilities. I'd like to come again.
Well, you have the openness, you have individuality, everybody knows you. You meet that, you have that friendliness when you go to the post office or to the store. In the summer, we sort of lose a little of it, but come this time of the year, we all get it back. It's a great place for kids. I can just think of 100 things. It's just the openness of it, yeah.
Also, the post office was right in the center of Amagansett. And in the morning, everybody met. Yeah, I mean, us kids, I remember that all the time. We'd go with our father, like, to go to the post office, and we'd be sitting in the back of the truck waiting. He'd be jibber-jabbing with somebody, you know, because that's where everybody met. But that really wasn't in East Hampton. East Hampton's more business-like.
The rural open spaces, the people, the sense of community, and just about everything. It's a splendid place to live, and I'm happy to live here.
It's quiet, it's peaceful, it's got all the small town characteristics that we like so much, and smaller than the surrounding communities, which we appreciate. We like the main street, quiet the way it is. It's just perfect. That's why we like it here.
Without a snorkel.
Well, there's a lot of things I like about Amagansett. Basically, it's a nice little tight-knit community, you know. Everybody knows everybody. Everybody gets along with everybody. Little no crime, no problems, you know. Everybody has a business owner or you know, a laborer or whatever, and everybody works and then enjoys themselves. You know, have great summers, go down the beach, you know. Everybody belongs to some sort of organization, you know, and it's just, you know, great people all around, basically, so.
Well, Amagansett is still a small village. East Hampton really has developed into an entertainment community. I mean, you buy things in Amagansett that you want to use, whereas you buy things in East Hampton, I think, that you want people to see. It's much more of a, well, I don't want to say glitzy because it's not fair to it, but it's developed differently in a business sense. This is still a town you live in. That's a place you visit.
Well, I like Amagansett because of its sense of being a village. And I even say that in contrast to being a town, that it's more like a village, and it is a village. I like the sense of immediacy of living with people whom I know, I mean, many of whom I know, not all, the sense of neighborhood, so that people on my lane, for instance, where I live, I know many of them by name and we can exchange greetings. There's just a sense of a close community.
It's the unhurried, uncrowded space. I very often can find a parking place on Main Street most of the time when I want it, and I don't feel that the environment is being paved over and crowded out. I think Amagansett has just enough of what we call the shopping center and so on for the people to be served and to keep the looks of the place.
They get more service than the small stores. When they go into a big department store or whatever, they're pretty much on their own in there. But when they come into all the small stores, the hardware store and, you know, the Estia's and the real estate stores or wherever, they get personal service. And they don't find that in the larger stores. And Amagansett, naturally, they're all small stores, family-owned, and everybody takes a great interest in the people that come in the store, and they like that.
For generations, the Edwardses have been connected with the water, and I consider it a privilege to have that opportunity to be a commercial fisherman, a privilege. You never know what is in that net, what type of fish. The varieties of the fish, it's like flowers of the field. When you're driving along the highway, you observe the flowers of the field, it draws your attention. Every time I haul that net back and dump the pocket on the after deck, it's the variety of not only fish, but shellfish, crabs and lobsters and what have you. It's a variety that seems though that there's something new every day.
I love Amagansett.
There's just a homey feeling about Amagansett. It's down to earth. It's really, it's still somewhat rural. It used to be much more so, but as with everything else, it's growing. But it's still rural, more than East Hampton, more than any other town around here, I think.
I guess I'd have to say the thing I like about Amagansett the most is that it's still quite rural. It's fairly undiscovered. It doesn't have every amenity that, let's say, Southampton has or Bridgehampton. And it's very quiet. It has water, it has farmland, it has woodland, and it's just a lovely place to live.
What I like here is what everybody else who lives here likes, and that's the tranquility, the peacefulness, the calm, the friendship of my neighbors, the love and friendship of my neighbors, because we do get along beautifully, the rural nature of Amagansett. I have everything I need here right now, and it's perfect for me. It's perfect.
I've been here for 68 years. This year is the biggest summer I've ever seen in my life. 20 years ago, we've seen a lot of farming. Potato farming, dairy farming. Today, I don't think we got 500 acres of potatoes in the whole town of East End. I'd rather see it like it was years ago. Everything around here, as a matter of fact, in back of the firehouse here was a big potato land. A fellow by the name of Bistrine used to farm it. And Lester, he used to farm a lot of it around here. And Jack Stella, he was an old farmer, he used to do the same thing. I enjoyed it. Today, we don't have nothing like that.
Oh, it's just, the traffic is horrendous. And everybody's in a hurry. It's not the locals, it's the people that come out. They don't abide by the rules, speed limit signs, yellow lines, doesn't mean anything.
I live Amagansett, please don't spoil it for me.